السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. راح أبدأ اليوم بالمحاضرة. I will start this lecture. This will be my first lecture in this series. I will talk about pituitary MRI, how to interpret images. Just for who interested in reading pituitary images. In this lecture, I will talk about basics. I will talk about normal anatomy, how to differentiate between cellular and supracellular masses, what is the differential diagnosis of supracellular masses, and cellular lesions, the most common cellular lesions, and finally, we will take some multiple choice questions. First thing, how to differentiate between the T1 and the T2 weighted images. It is quite simple to differentiate between these images. The gray matter will be dark on the T1 weighted images, while it will be bright, just like this here, in the T2 weighted image. The white matter is inverted. It will be white in the T1 weighted image, while it will be dark in the T2 weighted image. The cerebrospinal fluid, like we see in this ventricles here, it is dark in the T1 weighted image, while it is bright in the T2 weighted image. Also, there are the flare time and the T1 contrast image. The flare, we don't need it in our pituitary imaging, and the T1 with contrast image will be talked about in the coming slides. Also, something important we should know about the pre and post contrast image, how to differentiate between them. The contrast will be in T1 weighted image, and it is also quite simple. This is the coronal image. We should differentiate the nasal concha. Pre-contrast image, it will be dark, just like the gray matter. After contrast, the gadolinium, it will be bright, brighter than the gray matter. Also, this is the dura matter, and the falx cerebri will be bright after injecting the contrast material. Also here in this image, this is the nasal concha. It is dark, just like the gray matter. While here after infusion, it is, bright. Also the calvus area here, but it is not very clear here. The calvus will be, we talk in Arabic, the al-munhadar. It is also will be bright after gadolinium infusion. The normal pituitary gland in size, it is about 3 to 8 millimeters in size. It is increased normally in females in the adolescents because the gonadotropins. Also, it is after immediately after in the postpartum period, reach about 12 millimeters height. In the primary hypothyroidism, also it is increased. The pituitary stalk is important to know its size. It is less than 4 millimeters. Pituitary greater than pituitary stalk greater than 4 millimeters is usually considered pathologic. This image, this pre-contrast image, and also this post contrast image. This is coronal sections. This is the third ventricle. It is important to know the structure of this area. Also, this is the optic chiasm. This is the pituitary stalk. This is the anterior pituitary. This is the internal carotid artery. The internal carotid artery in this area make a loop. So when we take a coronal section, we will see two images for the internal carotid artery. It is important to know some points about this image. Here, it is the most important component in this area. It is the cavernous sinus. The cavernous sinus endures some very important the organs like the carotid artery, the third, fourth, sixth cranial nerves, and the fifth and the ocular part of the trigeminal nerve. These two internal carotid artery images, if we draw a theoretical line between in the middle of them, this theoretical line helps us to know if any pituitary tumor, if it is lateral to this line, that means more than 40% of the cavernous sinus is invaded by the tumor, which really it is a nightmare for the neurosurgeon during the surgeries for the pituitary tumors. This is a sagittal image for the same patient, also a pre and post contrast. This is the third ventricle. This is the optic chiasm. And this is the pituitary stalk. This is the anterior pituitary. And just posterior to it, the posterior pituitary, it is seen like a bright line posterior to the anterior pituitary. Another important component here, it is the sphenoid sinus. The sphenoid sinus is the entrance of the transsphenoidal surgeries, which is the common approach in most pituitary tumors. Another important point here is the mammillary body. The mammillary body, its importance from the tuber cinereum, which is the area between the pituitary stalk and the mammillary body, which makes a very important site for most common lesion in precocious puberty, as we will talk about later. This image shows us how the pituitary stalk and the pituitary gland homogeneously take the contrast also. Now we will talk about supracellular lesions, and the most common lesions in adults is extension from a pituitary adenoma, supracellular meningioma, and aneurysms, while in children, craniopharyngioma and hypothalamic glioma and aneurysms also. My approach will be case-based in these coming slides. I will just as my voice is clear, just is my voice clear, but somebody was just give me a hand. Okay, thank you. I will continue then. This is the first case.
We are listening to you.
Okay. The first case, a 30-year-old man came to the endocrine clinic with coarse features developed over years. This patient has had hypertension and type 2 diabetes. He had elevated IGF-1 and unsuppressed growth hormone after 75 grams glucose administration. You asked for a pituitary imaging. This image, this is coronal image. Show us this lesion here. Also in this image, this is a pre-contrast, and both we see here the optic chiasm is compressed here. Also, the optic chiasm is compressed here. This is the theoretic line between the carotid artery openings, and the tumor reaches lateral to them. This is the tumor tissue here. And some points about the acromegaly, we see this enlarged frontal sinus, also this occipital fold here. This is common signs in the acromegaly. Also, we see this tumor expands the cilia. In the normal, in the plain X-rays for the cilia torsisa, we will see it enlarged here, and this tumor invade to the sphenoid sinus. When we see this lesion, the most point to differentiate if it is a tumor invaded the cilia torsisa or a tumor originated from the cilia torsisa and extended supercilar to the supercilar area, we will see the cilia torsisa. If it is enlarged, extended, that means the origin of the tumor from the cilia and extended supracilia. Okay. The second also important point here that the tumor respect the carotid artery. We see here this this internal carotid artery endorsed by the tumor tissue, but it is not stricted or compressed. The second case, you were asked to see a 48-year-old lady in the neurosurgery department. The patient had headache and vision abnormality. Hormonal study was normal. Electrolyte and osmolality were normal. You examined the MRI pictures and found these two lesions. This is in the parietal lobe here. And this is in the supracellular area here. We see homogeneous enhancement in this lesion. And this lesion also compress the cilia torsisa area, and also these carotid arteries are compressed here. And also this image is post contrast, as we see the dura mater and fox cerebri bright. This image also show the same lesion or similar lesion actually. This sign is very, very important, the dural tail called, and this is the lesion, homogeneous enhancement. Also, it is compressed, the anterior pituitary here. This is the, an important point to differentiate between supracellular lesion, or the, يعني specifically the meningioma. The meningioma doesn't respect the carotid artery or the arteries in general. They compress the artery when go to around it, while the pituitary tumors do not compress the arteries. So meningioma, the enhancement and thickening of the adjacent dura is referred to a dural tail, and it is a characteristic sign. This sign is characteristic dural tail for the pituitary, for the meningiomas, and the meningioma show uniform enhancement. Post IV contrast.
Oui, c'est
The third case, you were asked to see an 8-year-old boy in the neurosurgery unit, symptoms and signs of polyuria, headache, and increased intracranial pressure, laboratory findings of central diabetes insipidus, growth hormone deficiency. You found the following lesions on MRI. We see this T2 weighted image, coronal image. This is a sagittal image, pre-contrast and post-contrast image. We see this component here and this component here. This is a cystic component, bright in the T1 weighted image. And also in the T1 weighted image, supposed contrast, bright cystic component. The solid component here is dark, while it is here bright after contrast material, and it show inhomogeneous enhancement after gadolinium infusion. Also, this is an axial image, and this is coronal image. This is the cystic component, and this is the solid component invading the whole area of the pituitary gland. Craniopharyngiomas may come in any age, 5%, 50% of cases in childhood less than 60 years. It is a benign lesion, but with a high recurrence rate, increased mortality. Cystic component is almost always present. Solid component has a high signal on MRI and increased enhancement after infusion. We see this is a pre-contrast image, and this is the post-contrast image. This is the solid component, dark in the pre-contrast. It becomes bright after the contrast. And this is the cystic component here. This is the pituitary gland in this image. The fourth case, a 50-year-old boy came to the endocrinology clinic with short stature. On examination, you found these lesions. This cafe au lait. And this is the leash nodules. So the patient was 2.5 standard deviations below the expected height and the bone age. He was diagnosed with growth hormone deficiency and hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism. After finishing study, the boy was diagnosed with neurofibromatosis type 1. You ask for catecholamine screening. It was negative, and brain MRI and shows this lesion. This is a pre-contrast image, and this is, and this is a T2 weighted image. And this is a T2 weighted image, show increased intensity for in this lesion, and this is a post contrast image, show this lesion also. This is the pituitary gland, and this is the pituitary stalk here. This is the anterior pituitary, as I mentioned. This lesion is seen, glioma is seen with the neurofibromatosis. Gliomas, low signal in T1 and high signal in T2. It may be heterogeneous, show heterogeneous or homogeneous enhancement after gadolinium infusion. This tumor usually is infiltrative, but when associated with the neurofibromatosis 1, they seem to be indolent. This is solid, not cystic lesion. This is the pre-contrast image here. This is the pituitary gland here. It is dark in the pre-contrast image, and it is heterogeneous enhancement here after contrast gadolinium infusion. The fifth case, a 7-year-old boy came to the endocrinology clinic by his parents, who were worried about increased aggressive behavior and enlarged genitalia. During workup, the patient was tunnel 3 stage in puberty, increased bone age by 2.5 standard deviations above the expected. Laboratory study confirmed the diagnosis of central precocious puberty. The MRI images showed these findings. We see this is the optic chiasm, this is the pituitary stalk, and this is the anterior pituitary. This lesion is a cystic lesion. This is an arachnoid cyst. The next lesion is the hamartoma. The hamartoma, I talked about it in the normal anatomy. It is the most common CNS tumor causing central precocious puberty. It is a benign lesion. It is located in the tuber cinereum between the mammillary body and the pituitary stalk. This lesion show no enhancement after infusion. It is iso-intense or hypo-intense in pre-contrast images. And post-contrast show no enhancement. As we see here, this is the anterior pituitary iso-intense. Here it is, take the contrast material, the anterior pituitary and the pituitary stalk. While here, the hamartoma show no enhancement. If we move to cystic lesions also, Rathke's cleft cyst, it has no solid component. There are no calcifications. The peripheral, the enhancement, if exists, will be peripheral. The Rathke's cleft cyst shows high signal on T2, just similar to the CSF, and shows iso intense signal in the T1 weighted image. And this point is quite important. We see here this in the pituitary gland. We don't recognize a cystic lesion in the pre-contrast image, while the post-contrast image show peripheral enhancement and low signal lesion, and this is Rathke cleft cyst. Another lesion, cystic lesions in the suprasellar area, epidermoid cyst. It is. It has a uniform character, just CSF-like. When we examine this lesion, we don't see any bright lesions within it, and that differentiate it from the dermoid cyst. In most cases, the dermoid cyst has a high signal in the cyst, according to the presence of the sebum. While in the epidermoid cyst, no frank macroscopic hyperintense signal to suggest sebum. The important point also to differentiate it from Rathke's cleft cyst, the content. The content is unclear, like here. This is a clear content, cystic, just cyst. While in the epidermoid cyst and dermoid cyst, we see components like sebum or either in the epidermoid cyst. Now we will summarize these suprasellar lesions. The craniopharyngioma, the cystic component hyperintense in the T1-weighted image and T2-weighted image. The enhancement is heterogeneous. The structure is solid and cystic components. The meningioma is iso or hypointense in the T1-weighted image, iso or hyperintense in the T2-weighted image. It shows in homogeneous enhancement, and it is a solid in structure. The glioma is hypointense in T1-weighted image. It is hyperintense in the T2-weighted image. It shows hetero or homogeneous enhancement, and it is also solid in structure. The hamartoma, it is hypointense in T1-weighted image, iso-intense in T2-weighted image, show no enhancement, and in structure, it is solid. The epidermoid and dermoid cyst, cystic components, epidermoid cyst show no sebum within it, while sebum is present in dermoid cyst. The T1-weighted image for epidermoid cyst show hypointensity, while in dermoid cyst, hypointense, but with intrinsic hyperintense signal. There are two hyperintense in the T2-weighted image, just like the CSF. The enhancement in the epidermoid cyst is peripheral, if it is existed, and in the dermoid cyst, either do not enhance or intrinsic according just to the component of the cyst. The arachnoid cyst is just similar to the CSF, hypointense in the T1-weighted image, hyperintense in the T1-weighted image, shows no enhancement at all, and its structure is cystic, purely cystic. Rathke's cystic cleft is iso-intense in T1 weighted image and hyper-intense in the T2 weighted image. It is cystic, show no enhancement or peripheral if existed, and it is cystic lesion. Now we will move to the pituitary lesions. The sixth case talk about a 37-year-old lady referred to the endocrine clinic for amenorrhea evaluation. She had galactorrhea. Prolactin was 200 nanograms per milliliter or 4,000 micro units per liter. You asked for a pituitary MRI and found this. This is the pre-contrast image. So this is the pituitary stalk and the pituitary stalk, and this is the aortic chiasm. This is the carotid artery. This is the pituitary, anterior pituitary. After enhancement, the image show optic chiasm here. This is the anterior pituitary. I will magnify this picture to see if this if there is any lesions here. There is no obvious lesions. This image also pre-contrast for the same patient, coronal and sagittal. This post-contrast normal, but if we take an early after infusion image, we show this lesion here. Also, in the sagittal and coronal image, we show this lesion. Why there, that is happened? The dynamic imaging in the imaging is a very important point in such lesions. The microadenomas, especially in the prolactinoma, especially in prolactinomas and Cushing disease. In some pituitary microadenomas, they mimic the normal tissue and show normal enhancement after infusion. So we take serial image immediately after infusion to catch the early lack of enhancement in the adenoma. The seventh case, a 23-year-old girl was asking you about increasing hair growth. No visual symptoms, no galactorrhea, no obesity. Back to the sixth case, dynamic imaging should be the model of imaging in any suspected microadenomas, especially in Cushing disease. In this case, no visual symptoms, no galactorrhea, no obesity. During workup, you found that prolactin was 97 and 170 nanogram per milliliter. You asked for the patient to do an MRI and shows this lesion. This is a T1 weighted image without contrast, show deviated pituitary stalk here and this lesion here, high intensity and well defined within the pituitary gland and a large pituitary gland. As I mentioned, this pituitary stalk here deviated to the other side. And this is lesion high intense in the T2 weighted image, and this is the sagittal image. The common question here is, what is this lesion? And this elevated prolactin is from a prolactinoma, or just this is a bleeding, or either lesion showed this, elevated this prolactin. This patient considered a pituitary prolactinoma bleeding pituitary prolactinoma. The high intensity in the T1 weighted image and the T2 weighted image, this high intensity in these two images points to a bleeding. So it is pituitary apoplexy. This patient has no symptoms of any emergencies. So she was treated with cabergoline, and this image taken after 3 months after treatment and shows normal size pituitary after treatment. Just this lesion stayed here, and this is the prolactinoma after treatment. So this was a bleeding prolactinoma here. The next case, you examined a 53-year-old patient in the neurosurgery unit admitted for subarachnoid hemorrhage and basilar mass on CT. On examination, visual abnormality, laboratory study showed prolactin 170 nanogram per milliliter. You asked for performing a pituitary MRI. This lesion was here. This is a ciliary lesion invading the sphenoid sinus and extended supraciliarly. And these lesions here, these subarachnoid hemorrhages. It is an obvious case of prolactinoma, and cabergoline had been started for this patient. Also, this is another case for a pituitary adenomas. We see the enlarged pituitary here. And the, of course, this is a T1 weighted image without contrast, pre-contrast image. And we see here a hypointense lesion, but it is not very that obvious. So the post-contrast image, the post-contrast images here show this lesion, about 30 millimeters lesion in the pituitary gland. After enhancement of the normal pituitary, except for the adenoma. This case was for a 38-year-old woman, came to the clinic with headache, enlarged hands and feet. She had elevated IGF-1 and unsuppressed growth hormone after 75-gram glucose test. She was diagnosed with acromegaly and managed successfully with transsphenoidal sinus. This is the T2 weighted image for this patient, and this the pituitary adenoma. The next case is for a 22-year-old man came to the neurologist to be evaluated for chronic headache and visual disturbance. A ciliary and supraciliar mass was found on the MRI, this lesion here. Hyperintense lesion in the supraciliar area and extend to the supraciliar area from the cilia toward the supraciliar area. And this is the stricture here because of the cilia torsisa diaphragm. The laboratory evaluation showed the panhypopituitarism but normal urine exertion. The surgery was done without cure. The hormonal replacement had been started and patients started radiotherapy for non-functioning pituitary tumor. And as is mentioned here, this is the optic chiasm. Also, this is another case of non-functioning pituitary adenomas. This is the pre-contrast image for this lesion from the pituitary, from the cilia torsisa extended superiorly. This is a post-contrast image show in homogeneous enhancement. And this is areas of hypointensity. This is a cystic changes that may be seen in the pituitary adenomas. This is the concha also very clear here. And this is the calvus, hyperintense and after infusion. The next case for a 50-year-old man was diagnosed with prolactinoma and treated with cabergoline 0.5 milligram twice weekly for 2 years. Now he came for re-evaluation in the endocrine clinic. Prolactin was normal. Other hormone secreting is also normal. We requested for a new MRI for the pituitary gland. And so this image. This is the pre-contrast image, and this is the post-contrast image. This is the optic chiasm. This is the pituitary stalk, and this thin line here, it is the anterior pituitary or the remained anterior pituitary. This is T2 weighted image. Show also here this. This is all CSF here, and this is the anterior pituitary or what remained of it. This is the anterior pituitary here. This case is for empty cilia. Empty cilia may be primary or secondary. Primary due to the arachnoid herniation through the congenital diaphragmatic defect, while secondary may be after surgery or radiotherapy or pituitary infarction. The majority of patients have normal pituitary function, hypopituitarism or hyperprolactinemia is found in about less than 10% of cases. The pituitary stalk terminates into an empty cilia, and only a small amount of pituitary tissue is identifiable at the base of the cilia. The pituitary gland in these cases is 2 millimeters or less. Also, this is a case of empty cilia. A good point to be remembered, if we draw an imaginary line between just above the optic, the carotid artery, this line helps us. If the pituitary stalk reaches this line, that means this case is empty cilia. If it is down to here, it is a complete empty cilia, while some cases just like this is partial empty cilia. This case show here, this is the pituitary stalk, reached the cilia torsisa base, and this line is here. This is a complete empty cilia. This case, you were asked to see a 20-year-old girl who was admitted to the hematology unit for anemia. The patient had amenorrhea since 5 months, had recurrent.
Yes, boss.
I'm sorry for this technical issue. I guess we should take the pro version of Zoom. I will continue. This patient had amenorrhea since 5 months and had recurrent episodes of hypocalcemia. On laboratory evaluation, she was found to have hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism. Okay. On laboratory evaluation, she was found to have hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism, the low prolactin and growth hormone, but normal cortisol and thyroid function test, and hypoparathyroidism. On hematology, she had a ferritin more than 2,000 nanogram per milliliter. So this case was compatible with hemochromatosis. The hemochromatosis characteristic sign is the blackness or the loss signal of the anterior pituitary in the T2 sequences. Of course, this is not the T2 sequences. This is T1, but the anterior pituitary all is black. It is an important point for the hemochromatosis to keep in mind, the blackness of the anterior pituitary. The next case is for a 65-year-old man was admitted to the endocrine wards for evaluation for the polyuria and polydipsia. He was a smoker, non-alcoholic, no previous known disorders. He performed the deprivation test, and the patient had central diabetes insipidus. You found this on MRI. This is a sagittal image for the pituitary area. This is the anterior pituitary. No signal of the posterior pituitary here, and this is common in the all diabetes insipidus cases, almost all of it, enlarged anterior pituitary and enlarged pituitary stalk here. After looking for a primary source, according to this MRI, was seeing another lesions in the vertebras, told us that it may be a metastasis. We looked for a primary tumor and found an apical lung mass. After biopsy, it shows small cell lung cancer. This is the optic chiasm, and this is the pituitary stalk enlarged. And this is the anterior pituitary also is enlarged. So this case is for pituitary metastasis. The infiltrative pituitary disease, just for hemochromatosis and metastasis, the most common, which is also be asked in exams, lymphocytic hepatocytosis. It comes with a thickened stalk, enlarged pituitary, diffuse enhancement of the pituitary and the stalk. It resembles tumors. We see here this anterior pituitary after infusion, and this is the pituitary stalk. And also we just think it as a tumor, but correlation with the clinical setting is important to differentiate it from other lesions. Other infiltrative pituitary disease, Langerhans cell histiocytosis, neurosarcoidosis, and Wiener's granulomatosis. All these lesions became almost all the same. Thickened pituitary stalk, enlarged pituitary, and diffuse enhancement after infusion. This hemochromatosis, we talked about it, how it comes. Pituitary lymphoma, just the primary pituitary lymphoma, similar to these lesions, and metastasis, as we see in this old man. This is the last case, I guess. A seven-year-old boy was being evaluated for short stature. Routine laboratory was normal. Low IGF-1, provoked growth hormone was low. He was found to have a secondary hypothyroidism and secondary adrenal insufficiency. Pituitary MRI was performed and show us this lesion. This is the absence of pituitary stalk here. This is the anterior pituitary. And this is a bright spot here. And the origin of the pituitary stalk, actually it is the posterior pituitary, ectopic posterior pituitary. This lesion was, this case was for a pituitary stalk interruption syndrome. Now we will move to some questions. The first, please, who just, this first question, a 65-year-old man presented to the accident and emergency unit with a sudden onset of headache, nausea, and vomiting. On examination, he was drowsy with the features of third and fourth and sixth cranial nerve palsy. An urgent magnetic MRI brain was arranged. Show this lesion. This image is quite unclear, but we see enlarged pituitary gland with a hyper intense within it. I think it is bleeding adenoma. All of the following are indications for for urgent neurosurgical intervention in a patient with a pituitary apoplexy, except please select one. Deteriorating level. This question is not for the image, but the questions in the exam may become image and something about it. The first choice is deteriorating level of consciousness, ocular paresis, third, fourth, and sixth cranial nerves, severe and persistent visual field defect, severely reduced visual acuity, worsening visual field defect. What do you think the answer is?
Ocular paresis. I think ocular paresis.
Okay, that's true. Ocular paresis is the answer. The another question here is for a 75-year-old retired army man was referred to the endocrine clinic with symptoms including recurrent headache, lethargy, and malaise. His general physical and systemic examination was remarkable. The free T4 and TSH was low. The FSH and LH was low. Testosterone was in the lower limit of normal. prolactin was slightly elevated. The cortisol was 9 a.m. cortisol was normal. The pituitary MRI showed this lesion and the T2 weighted image. Which one of the following is a definitive indication for elective surgery in a patient with non-functioning pituitary adenoma? This case is also not for imaging modeling, just for something about the lesion. First choice, abnormal short synectin test results, optic chiasm compression, recurrent headaches, secondary hypothyroidism, and the tumor size. What do you think?
Optic chiasm compression.
Optic chiasm.
Exactly. Optic chiasm compression is a definitive indication for a surgery. This question also, this is the MRI scan of a 22-year-old female who presented with a 6-month history of secondary amenorrhea. She is otherwise well, and there are no abnormalities on physical examination.
Optic chiasm.
From the history of... and MRI appearance, what is the most likely diagnosis? It is acromegaly or Kallmann syndrome, microprolactinoma, non-functioning pituitary tumor, or polycystic ovarian syndrome. I will magnify this image here. This is the pituitary, anterior pituitary.
On the right side of
and
the
we show, we see this lesion here, okay? So it is a microprolactinoma. The another question, a 37-year-old woman with a 6-month history of your tiredness and lethargy is admitted as an emergency complaining of a severe retroorbital headache and visual disturbance. On examination, she has a left third nerve palsy. The findings of an urgent MRI scan are shown in the image. What we see here? We see a large pituitary gland, hyper intense here. And this image, I guess it is without contrast. What is the most likely diagnosis? This emergency with this image, what make us think about? Subarachnoid hemorrhage due to a posterior communicating artery aneurysm or hemorrhage into a pituitary macroadenoma, lymphocytic hypophysitis with suprasellar extension, hemorrhagic hypophysitis, or empty cilia syndrome. What do you think?
Maybe hemorrhage in the pituitary macroadenoma.
Yes, that is true. This 20-year-old student presented to the endocrine clinic for review. He is concerned as the over the past few months he had suffered from a progressive loss of yes of long intercourse and and now has problems maintaining an erection. This had led to a breakup of a long-term relationship. Examination reveals normal blood pressure and pulse. There is no postural drop in blood pressure. Chest is clear, abdomen is soft and non-tender, and this BMI is normal. Neurological examination system is normal, apart from some evidence of temporal visual field loss. Investigation shows normal hemoglobin and white blood cell counts, platelets, sodium, creatinine, and potassium all normal. Prolactin was elevated. Cross-sectional image show this image. This is a lesion within the pituitary gland. I think the calvus is has a high intensity. High intense, so it is after infusion. It is not enough to talk just for one image in one section. This lesion may be what? A filling defect in the pituitary gland after infusion. Maybe a cystic lesion. It is not clear actually. This is, which of the following is most likely diagnosis? A meningioma? I don't think so. Pituitary apoplexy? It will be hyperintense. Pituitary macroadenoma, maybe. But it's similar. Here is About the CSF, pituitary micro or Rathke cliff cyst?
I think cyst.
Yes.
It is Rathke cliff cyst.
Yes, exactly. It is Rathke cliff cyst. The hypointensity in this lesion is similar to the cerebrospinal fluid, so I guess it is cystic more than pituitary microadenoma. This is a long case. A 60-year-old man presented with a several weeks history of polyuria and polydipsia. He reports no headache, but he does have double vision. He previously smoked 20 cigars per day for 30 years, but stopped 3 years ago. He has no notable medical history and takes no medications. On physical examination, he appears thin and pale. His skin is dry. His height is 175 centimeters and 68 kilograms. BMI normal. Blood pressure is normal. Resting pulse is slightly decreased. Examination of his cranial nerves reveals right sixth nerve palsy. Water deprivation test confirmed central diabetes insipidus. Cortisol in the morning, 8 a.m. is 24 micrograms per deciliter. It is 24 normal. TSH and free T4 central hypothyroidism. FSH, LH, testosterone also is decreased. Prolactin is normal. IGF-1 is low. This is panhypopituitarism. MRI showed this lesion. What do you think? This is an enlarged pituitary gland and pituitary stalk. Which of the following is most likely cause of pituitary pathology in this patient? Pituitary macroadenoma, craniopharyngioma, meningioma, pituitary metastasis, Rathke's cliff cyst.
I think cranial.
Craniopharyngioma.
Solid and cystic.
Yes, exactly. There should be cystic and solid lesion. But in this old man, and this is an enlarged pituitary pituitary stalk, we will talk about, as I mentioned earlier, we will talk about infiltrative disease. Okay, which one of these is?
Cystic metastasis.
Okay, exactly. Mm-hmm. That is what I'm talking about. It is a pituitary metastasis. A 55
macroadenoma. Dr. Ibrahim, sorry.
What?
In the last case, why not pituitary macroadenoma?
Pituitary macroadenoma actually doesn't cause a thickening of the pituitary.
It looks like hyperplasia or infiltration. Exactly.
A 50-year-old man presented with a disturbance in vision. On examination, there was a symmetrical bitemporal hemianopia affecting the upper quadrants of the visual field.
The common meningioma.
Yes, exactly. There's no need to mention any choices. It is a common meningioma. This is the dorsal tail. It is the homogeneous enhancement in the subracellular area. This is for a 49-year-old woman presented with a progressive loss of vision in both eyes. She was otherwise well, and her only medication was hormonal replacement therapy. Examination showed bitemporal lower quadrant.
Cranial or what?
Yes.
Cranial.
Yes. Regardless of this test, this is a cystic lesion here. And this is the solid part. This is pre-contrast and this is post-contrast. So it is obviously craniopharyngioma. This is my last slide, I think.
You are the best.
Thank you very much, all of you for your participating.
شكرا دكتور ابراهيم جزاك الله كل خير والله
شكرا شكرا جزيلا لكم جميعا ان شاء الله تعالى في اي اسئله او استفسارات تحبوا قبل ما ننهي اللقاء
حضرتك كنت قلت هتعمل سيريال محاضرات يعني كذا محاضره
ان شاء الله ان شاء الله اعتقد باذن الله تعالى لازم الاسبوع القادم في نفس الموعد اذا ما استجد شيء انا راح اخبركم عن الموعد ان شاء الله
ان شاء الله ان شاء الله
شكرا وهي الريكوردينج راح ارفعه قريبا بس اجهزه ان شاء الله تعالى
تسلم
شكرا جزيلا
شاكرين دكتور ابراهيم شاكرين والله
تحياتي دكتور محمود
شاكرين شكرا دكتور ابراهيم
الله يسلمكم جميعا السلام عليكم ورحمه الله
عليكم السلام ورحمه الله
شكرا جزيلا دكتور ابراهيم شكرا
جميعا